strikes me that, you know, you seem to enjoy the to mess around with music, to change things, to be allowed to change it. Do you feel that, I mean, that's permission to create, but it's also permission to ruin.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, you know, how do you kind of reconcile those kind of decisions?
Yeah, I mean, that's a fair point. I could start talking about sort of theoretical precedents and that kind of thing. People do desecration. Palimpsest is a good word. Palimpsest, where, you know, you might get a canvas, a painting, and someone will come along and paint something else over it. Someone else might say, you know, drawing a moustache on the Mona Lisa. I just kind of like that approach. And I think, well, why would I want to hear, for example, a song by John Dowland, just always done in the same way? Mm. Oh, there's this singer, this singer, this singer, which you prefer. Oh, they're all fine. Yeah. You know, nothing wrong with it. It's great. But then suddenly one day someone like John Potter comes along and does an album with an improvising bass clarinet, you know, and percussion on top of it, or you get Sting singing it with Edin Karamazov, or you get Addis doing this. So I'm interested in that, really, that kind of sullying, dirtying. I mean, there are composers who don't like this. There are composers who are totally obsessed, of control freaks. I could name a few, but maybe I won't. who like things done in a very particular way, and that's kind of fine. Yeah. I prefer to be a bit more subversive.
Sure. No, I tend to agree that, you know, an expression, you can't, you know, cook without breaking some eggs or something like that. You know, in the sense that, you know, you may have a number of people who ruin things, but for your point of view, but then that's the price of having people who do things like that. There's some amazing composers also who have very restrict ideas. I mean, I think Stravinsky was one of those who was kind of quite rigid about how people performed his work. And, you know, is it a challenge for you as a composer to come up against that?
Yeah, I mean, there's an interesting project a few years ago. Some friends of mine made a CD of all my works, and they took a piece which wasn't written for the ensemble they played, and they just completely just took it and improvised and played around with it and completely destroyed it and put it back together again in a completely changed, different state. I was kind of fine about that. Mm-hmm. But there is a slightly weird thing that happens to me, which is when I'm in the middle of a composition project and I'm actually writing the piece, I care an enormous amount about every tiny detail. Mm-hmm. But as soon as, you know, the performances have happened, or the recording, more often than not, has taken place, then I have no wish to go back and tinker.
So it's almost like it's a series of creative actions, and once it's done...
Yeah, then you move on to the next project, the next project. And they kind of get left behind in the dust a bit. Yeah. I mean, maybe we should hear something from the quartet. This is the quartet that Stuart and I played in. Actually, the quartet did its very last concert last year at a festival in Germany. So we were together for 27 years. I say we were together, but it's a bit like someone having a shovel with only it lasting 30 years and only having 10 new handles and 4 new heads. I was the only member of the quartet who remained throughout. Stuart, you were in for the last many years?
2 years.
Last two years. And so it was a lot of fun. So this is an arrangement. This is Carmen, something that probably everyone knows. And this is probably the piece that we played the most. It was a huge 25-minute Carmen fantasy. This is just a minute and a half or so from the Segedia. Thank you.
is it? I mean, it's always been interesting for me, coming into the quartet as I did with this kind of existing repertoire that Steve's created. Well, that was kind of the interesting point for me, because coming in, I'd heard a few arrangements of Carmen on guitar and guitar groups and things, and they'd always been very much Carmen and their arrangements. And when I played yours, it wasn't, and I was aware of that. But I didn't know why it was yours.
You see what I mean.
And yeah, I'm interested by that.
This is a tricky thing. I mean, one thing you're always told when you're being taught composition, as I was, and I went through all the standard routes, did a PhD in composition and so on, there's always seemed to be this sort of idea that a composer should have a recognizable style. Something that was a sort of, you'd put on a CD and within 2 seconds you could tell who it was. And this somehow is a good thing. And that's certainly, with Stravinsky, for example, who I think is sort of totally up there, you can almost hear 2 seconds of Stravinsky and not only know it's him, but know almost to the year when it was written. So sort of, his music is always changing, always moving forward, never resting on its laurels. It's always like, okay, what's the next thing, what's the next thing? But there's also a quote from W.H. Auden, who once said that an artist spends the first half of their career copying other people, and the second half copying themselves. And one of the things that I was always afraid of as a composer was not finding a style, as it were, but actually being limited and only being able to do a couple of different things. So in a sense, what I'm still aiming to do is to make things as different as possible. Because I think it's almost as if you pick something up as an outsider that is sort of to do with that artist or that composer, which the composer can't necessarily see or understand for themselves. It's too, like their habits in the way they speak, the kind of sentences they use. It's like when your children point out things that you keep saying, you think, oh, God, yeah. That's in a sense how it is. So I think as a composer, the thing I've always tried to do is try and make stuff as different as possible. And if you say it always sounds like me, then maybe I've failed in that. I think it's a tricky one. Mm-hmm. Because one of the things they don't really prepare you for when you're learning composition is actually you've got to keep doing it all the time for the rest of your life. And if your skill set is relatively small, you can only do certain things very well, then you're not going to develop or grow or change. Mm-hmm. So in a sense, the thing that interests me most is to try and do the opposite of what I've just done. So that, with each project, it's like, okay, if I've done something long and serious, I'll do something short and frivolous. Mm-hmm. If I've done something that is entertaining, I'll do something which is more thoughtful. So there's always this sort of change and, mm-hmm. So I think my main fear is repeating myself.
But do you think in your career, therefore, you've sort of moved away from the more arranging transcription part of your composition and moved towards something else, or is it sort of, does it come sort of randomly and without any particular scheme or development?
This is tricky. I mean, I teach in the University of Surrey, and I've been teaching there a long time. And I find it very easy to talk about other people's music, very easy to sort of follow lines of trajectory and say, look, this is what this composer does. They start here, they go here, they do this. With my own stuff, I'm like a football manager, I play each game as it comes, and not thinking about the bigger picture, but that's basically how it is. Mm-hmm. At the moment I've got to write a concerto for violin, guitar, strings, percussion, which I have to do very soon.
Right.
And I've got some ideas for that. Mm-hmm. And then after that there's another piece, after that there's another piece. But always I'm just thinking about the next thing,
okay,
what I'm working on and what that project is going to be. To stand back and look back, I tend not to do my mm-hmm. own stuff, and I would. But the point about the transcription and the composing is an interesting one, because I sort of combine the two a lot in all my work. I think I'm less self-conscious about it now. I don't care really what people think anymore. Mm-mm. I used to care a lot. Yeah. Now there are two kinds of critics: there are brilliant critics and there are ignorant critics. And it doesn't worry me so much, because there's enough to worry about actually getting the stuff written,
yeah,
let alone whether it develops on your style from the previous piece or does anything like that. So I think, I would very much see each project as a project that's kind of closed in, and I'm only thinking about the pragmatics. I would say, you mentioned earlier that I'm quite pragmatic. Mm-hmm. I think I'm highly pragmatic. And in a sense, I think that's why my music gets played so much, is because I think so much about the context in which it's going to get played. So if I write a piece for a guitarist or a pianist, I'll know what their concerts are like. I'll know how long is too long to have a new piece in their concert. I'll know what kind of piece will fit with the rest of the repertoire. Mm-hmm. So that when I've written it and I hand it to them, I know A, it'll be what they want, and B, they'll keep playing it. Mm-hmm. Other people will play it later, and they do, but when I'm writing the piece, I'm only thinking about that one commission, that one mm-hmm. thing. With this concerto I'm writing at the moment, it's an Italian guitarist who's sort of behind the project, mm-hmm. and he wanted some kind of Italian feel, and the conductor of the orchestra said, Italian Paganini. I was like, well, done that. And then it was like, well, I'm really interested in the novels of Italo Calvino, but I've never had time to read them. Mm-hmm. So if I do a project about them, I'll have to read them. And this is kind of what's happened throughout my career. It's just like I've got interest in stuff. And I thought, well, in order to actually read the books and do the work, I'm going to have to do it. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it's just not going to happen. Because, you know, up to that point, you'd have a novel and you'd have it by the side of your bed and you'd read two pages and put it down. And a year later, you think, well, I'll put that back on the shelf, unread. And I suppose, in a sense, you know, the project is about finding things out sort of separate from the music. Sure.
Because, you know, from where I'm sitting, it sounds, you know, like it's very much part of a process that you've got. It's almost like a, you know, a material generation stage, which, you know, you're using, if you like, an algorithm of kind of like, well, what am I interested in at the moment? What are the yeah. pragmatic parts of what needs to be achieved? Yeah. And then you get some material, and then the actual sort of work happens. I mean, how do you think that, how does that fit, though, with, like, originality? I mean...
Yeah, I mean, originality is not something I would want to worry about. Nothing's original. And things only seem original to people who listen to them and are ignorant of the things they're copied from, mm-hmm. basically. I mean, it was Stravinsky who said that, many people have said it, but, you know, good artists borrow, great artists steal. And what I think what happens to me in certain situations is I'll get the green light from something. And I'll say, if that person can do that, then I'm definitely doing this. Whereas I wouldn't have done this if I hadn't had the green light from that person doing that. An example would be, Uri Kane is a jazz pianist, American jazz pianist, who has played jazz Mahler, basically, in concerts. And until I heard him do it, I wouldn't have dreamt of arranging Mahler for guitar. But because someone had done something far more extreme than what I would do, that kind of gave me permission, mm-hmm. if that makes sense.
That makes a lot of sense. And that idea of permission, therefore, meaning that you can go forward in a direction which actually sort of becomes original in itself because it's not been done. So it's interesting thing to observe, this idea of taking something which comes from, maybe it's got its roots in arrangement and transcription and things, and actually making a process which creates, you know, sort of, you don't like the word original, but some kind of original.
Well, something that's different. I mean, one of the things, I teach a lot of composers through their PhDs, and one of the things they've got to prove is some kind of contribution to knowledge. Mm-hmm. And it's basically being, all they've really got to do is show that they're the first person to add that particular element with that particular element. I mean, I think one of the ways in which the human mind works is that you're basically just connecting things that haven't been connected before, because the imagination can cope with it. So, for example, if I were to say to you, imagine a purple chocolate mountain, you all can. We all know they don't exist. But the idea of a purple chocolate mountain is something the brain can configure. And I suppose in music, that's what happens to me. I said, imagine combining this with this. What would happen when you did that? Mm-hmm. You know, let's see. You know, sometimes it doesn't work, and sometimes it does.
Okay. Well, shall we listen to another piece? Because you mentioned permission. I think the barrier.
Yeah. I mean, I think most composers have a piece that suddenly turns the light on for them. I've certainly had several, but one in particular is Berio's Sinfonia. I think it's a piece where, when every composer hears it for the first time, there's this whole, oh my God, you know. And what happens in this piece, it was written in 1968, a very crucial year in many, many ways, lots of things culturally shifting at that time. But the third movement of the Sinfonia is basically based on, we're back to Mahler again, on a Mahler scherzo from the Second Symphony, which lies at the bottom of the piece. That scherzo in itself is based on a song by Mahler. But Berio's piece then is suddenly infused with all these references and all this sort of coding and all this sort of multiple layers of stuff going on. in my 20s, I was totally obsessed with James Joyce, just totally obsessed. I just found it incredibly interesting that you could have so many references and so much depth to something that, you know, you can hear a surface or read a surface and pick something up. And then again, this whole thing about going back and mining deeper and deeper. I started working my way through Finnegan's Wake with this sort of manual called McHugh. And it goes in and shows where all the different words come from and how it goes on. I mean, for example, there's a phrase in Finnegan's Wake, let's think, narcissists are the doters of inversion. Okay, it's just one sentence, or even half a sentence. Narcissists are the doters of inversion. Okay, so of course, necessity is the mother of invention. And also Narcissus, looking in the reflection, narcissism. Narcissists, as in mummy's boy, mm-hmm. as in doters of inversion, inversion, cross-dressing. Mm-hmm. And it's also tied up with all the characters in the book, and multiple characters, multiple facets of characters. Mm. So, you know, within one sentence there's all this and more that I won't have, you know. And the guy spent years and years and years writing this piece. And so the idea of having a piece that has all these sort of semiotic resonances, which is why the Berio is amazing. So what happens in the Berio Sinfonia is you have a Mahler scherzo at the bottom, which plays throughout the whole movement, in the whole orchestra. Sometimes it's all there, sometimes half the orchestra's missing, sometimes the whole thing's missing, but the footprint of the Mahler, the empty bars are still there. On top of that, Berio throws in quotes from millions of other pieces, and also text from Samuel Beckett, from a novel called The Unnameable. And he has all these little reference the whole time. And so there's speech, and there are quotes, and there's all these things sort of thrown in, and it's incredibly self-indulgent, horrifically 60s, but very, very sort of exciting and invigorating. Yeah, let's hear the beginning of it. If it's new to you, it's very confusing, there's far too much going on, but in a sense, that's the point. And you may hear quotations from music by Debussy and Stravinsky and all sorts just sort of thrown in on top. Let's hear a bit of the Berio.
Yeah, we talked a lot about some quite, you know, sort of abstract things, you know, but in terms of you as a person, when in your lifetime did this kind of permission to do this happen? I mean, what stage of your career were you at? And
well, I think it sort of drip-fed through. I've always sort of, I think when I was a student, even as a student, I didn't really do what I was told to do. Mm-hmm. I was always sort of fighting against what was kind of the accepted thing to do. I mean, I suppose it's going back to, you know, oh, there are too many violinists, I'm a guitarist now, mm-hmm. actually. And I think I probably wasn't much fun to teach. now I think about it.
Rebel?
You know, I remember talking to, I taught at the Yehudi Menuhin School for 6 years. I had a wonderful time. I had a friend there called Peter Norris, a fantastic man, brilliant musician. And I was once having a conversation, you know, about teenage years and some of the teenagers at the school who were proving problematic. And I said to him, well, the thing is, you know, Peter, when I was that age, I was horrifically arrogant. And he said, oh, even then. So, got an extract to finish the first half. I mentioned that I taught at the Yehudi Menuhin School. It's a very, very special place to me. Shortly after I stopped teaching there, in 2000, a few years later, they got a huge grant from the Rolling Stones, actually, to teach guitar there, because they didn't teach guitar up to that point. I was teaching composition, history, harmony, ear training, all that kind of stuff. And the director of music, Malcolm Singer, he phoned me up and said, Steve, we've got this huge grant, $500,000, to teach guitar at school. And we thought you'd be the perfect person to recommend someone for the job. Yeah, thanks. But shortly after they started teaching guitar, they actually commissioned me to write a piece. The menu in hall, which is a hall on the school premises, was this sort of huge pipe dream while I was working there. And it finally came to fruition in 2005. It is the most fantastic space. If you've not been there, I recommend a visit. And I was commissioned to write a piece for the school for the opening season of the hall. In fact, it was for Founders Night, which is Yehudi's birthday. And this was his 90th birthday. Would have been his 90th birthday if he was still alive, the night of the performance. And so it was a very special commission for me. And I thought, well, it's about the opening of a building, so I'll write a piece about architecture. Very interested in architecture. So I wrote a 7-movement piece. Each movement was about a different building. The East Stand of Highbury Stadium was one of the movements. It's my Arsenal football ground, as was. That year we were moving from the old ground to a new ground, so that had to be in there. But the first movement of the piece was about the Menuhin Hall itself. So the first thing that you notice when you go in the Menuhin Hall is that for the first time anywhere on the school premises, you hear silence. The M25 is horrifyingly close to the school. Right next to it, but so that when you're wandering around, wherever you are, you can hear the road. And so I went into the hall for the first time, and suddenly there was this amazing silence. The road completely sort of cut off, and it was just beautiful. I mean, it was an incredible silence. I thought, well, okay, so the piece has to start with the silence. So my piece begins with its fourth violin, viola, cello, guitar. It begins with people actually miming, so that people have to listen to the silence. And then out of the silence comes this sort of, it's almost as if the silence diminuendos as the music comes to take its place. And then as the piece kind of gets going, there are these big chords, which are simply there to make a noise so that you can hear the acoustic of the room. But then I thought, okay, that's the resonance of the room. And then I thought, okay, it has to resonate with the music from this place. So it has to have in it quotations and references to all the music that I associated with the place. So in it, you'll hear the whole movement, it's only about four minutes. You've got this sort of opening section. And then there's some quotations of Beethoven, which are quite disguised. Then some stuff from Richard Strauss's Metamorphosen, kind of in the background. And then out of it, again, this sort of blending thing, comes Schubert's Litany, which is a song that all 29 violinists played at Menuhin's funeral in unison. And Menuhin's funeral took place at the school in quite a boring room, less glamorous than this one. Lots of people crammed in. And then all 29 violinists played this song, and it was the most incredibly moving moment. You know, the piano was just an upright piano, but it was just extraordinary. So the piece remembers that moment, so the song comes out. Then it dies away again and into Verklärte Nacht, a quote from Verklärte Nacht, a piece that was often played at the school, Schoenberg's Verklärte Nacht, and finishes again in a kind of veiled Beethoven thing. So that you get within the movement the resonance of the room itself, the building, the school, the man, and the sort of historical musical canon, really. So let's hear that and then go and have a glass of wine.
you.